Hello, everybody, and welcome to this week's edition of Wine Wednesday. We have Stef Montague with us. She is an expat blogger, and I'm just super excited to share a glass of something with her because this time I haven't got wine because I wanted to bring the topic of networking, multicultural, cross-cultural networking into it. And since I'm in the UK, I decided to come armed with a teapot. and I filled it with gin and tonic. So I'm just going to go ahead and help myself to that.
So I personally actually have alcohol-free rosé.
Love it.
For me. But to coincide with this cross-cultural thing, I actually, my boyfriend is going to be so happy because I pre-poured him a beer into our joint. So for context, this is my head and this is the size of the glass. This is a 1 liter beer glass. And yeah, that's one bottle of beer in there. So it's only like half.
Whoa. That's hilarious. So tell us, I'm really excited to have you on this edition of Wine Wednesday because I've been asked multiple times what it's like to be in the UK as an American. You know, have there been any differences with regards to culture? You know, someone who's interested in networking, has it been difficult to get past the British stiff upper lip as it is described? And I thought you'd be perfect because you are a Brit living abroad. So we can have a really fun conversation around what it's been like. But I really just kind of wanted to quickly share your story about how you got to Germany and, you know, how long you've lived there.
Neither my boyfriend nor I ever had any kind of big dream or like drive to want to live abroad. We had talked about it, but it was just like, oh, wouldn't it be great one day? This opportunity just came up for my boyfriend to come and work over here. And so, yeah, my boyfriend was just like, okay, you know what? I'm going to go and try it. So he came out here for a week, did an interview, did like a trial shift and that sort of thing, explored the area a little bit, and completely fell in love. It was love at first sight for him.
So what part of Germany is it?
So we're actually in Bavaria, which I feel like we've probably been spoiled because neither of us has actually been to Germany before we moved here. For sure, like the nicest part of Germany, I think, personally. I'm biased because I live here, but...
I hear it's amazing, yeah, especially in that Munich area. I've really heard how beautiful it is. And how long have you lived there?
My boyfriend moved in July 2019, and then I followed in the September. Right. So about 18 months now, yeah.
Love it. I just love that. I mean, sometimes you don't actually mean to end up where you are. I definitely relate to that because I was supposed to just be in the UK for a year to study abroad, and that was almost 6 years ago, so you never know. So I want to talk about a little bit how you started networking in Germany, because from what I understood, it wasn't something that you really did too much of in the UK. So talk me through, you know, the before and after.
I say I didn't network at all. I did, but I didn't realize that I was networking.
Yeah.
Think, which is the case for most people in life. And then obviously when we moved to Germany, I quit my job in the UK and didn't have a job to go to and didn't speak any German, but I had the best kind of mentor in actually my neighbor. She is a local journalist and a self-employed kind of freelance writer and stuff. So she had access to so many different people, and she was incredible. She was kind of an integral part of my able to stay here because she wrote my CV for me in German, so she translated it all into German for me. She, like everyone she interviewed for a newspaper, she was like, are you looking for anyone to come and work for you? Because I'd been there for a few months and I'd applied for jobs that I like wanted, but I wasn't getting anywhere. And so yeah, and so my neighbor found this job for me, the job that I'm in now. the past few months, I've been sort of more intentionally networking, and not necessarily for jobs or career opportunities, but just to kind of meet new people, because the Germans aren't, there's this kind of preconception that the Germans are cold and unfriendly. And in my experience, that is absolutely not true. But most of them, especially in this area, most of them kind of like meet their friends at school. Mm. And then that's it. That's their friendship group. And it's quite hard to kind of crack into an already solid friendship group with a really long history.
Yeah.
And so networking, my Instagram has been the best place for me to kind of network. And I've met so many incredible people, particularly women, that are living and working in Germany. And that's kind of really built my confidence up and really helped me to start branching out and get new contacts. Yeah.
I love that. And it's funny that you say about this misconception around, you know, Germans being cold, because I had that as well, probably. But I also had the same misconception with British people. I had this idea in my head that there wasn't going to be a warm welcome. However, there really, really was. And I actually found really similarly that people meet each other in school or in university, and then there's that really strong group of friends. And so it was also really difficult for me to break into that. And I felt like that was as well the same reason why I really started being intentional around my networking, because I was struggling to break into those friendship groups. And like you said, Instagram has been such an amazing tool for meeting just the most amazing people. Or what would you say is a tip for someone who is facing a new culture, feels like that culture might not be so receptive, but you know, what is that encouragement that you would give to kind of continue to try to, you know, fit into the local community? Because I'm sure you've also met people, you know, locally within your job, that kind of thing. What would you say is a tip for kind of helping to break through that ice?
The biggest thing I found was, because the biggest thing here, obviously, was the language barrier. In that I had no German at all. Actually, even though you're kind of intentionally networking and you're trying to kind of force your way into these people's lives, it was more a case of actually taking a step back and listening and observing how they talk and what they do. The Germans, and I've started doing it now, the Germans talk with their hands so much. Sometimes they'll do a hand movement, a hand gesture, and they won't say the phrase that goes with that hand gesture because they'll just assume that you know what they're doing when they do it. So there's one that's like, I think it's like this, when basically you're like shouting at another driver. It's like road rage. Really? Shouting at another driver, being like, are you stupid? Like, what are you doing?
Like, are you blind?
Yeah, I think so. And it's yeah, it's stuff like that, especially in a new culture that you're not kind of so aware of, rather than kind of bulldozing my way in, which I don't really do anyway because I'm quite an introvert, so I'm quite shy when I kind of first meet new people. It helped me to kind of take a step back and just kind of listen and watch. And that I was told was that the Germans are very formal, very formal culture when it comes to business. But actually, whether it's Bavaria or whether it is just specifically the region that I live in, it's business as casual, as in, it's unless it's my boss, I address with the formal tone. But basically every other colleague, it's all informal.
I really love that idea of just stepping back and observing, because with culture, it does, people try and boil down culture into like a handbook of this is what the culture is about, and this is the way that they behave in certain situations. But it never does turn out to be that way when you're actually living in that culture. The differences in the way that people approach things here has meant that I've become a better networker, because I probably did take a little bit of a bulldozing approach at first, because I just was like wanting people to like me so badly. And it's probably similar within, you know, sort of German culture, that they don't really like that sort of full-on type personality. Do you find that there are like preconceptions that Germans have about you, because as an American, they kind of expected me to be loud and obnoxious. Was there something that as an, you know, as a Brit, they expected from you?
Okay, so the first one, which is probably the most recent one, and it's not necessarily a stereotype about Brits, but all of my German colleagues expect me to fully understand Brexit. And right. They come to me with all of these like export questions of like, how do I do this now that Brexit's happening? What happens here with Brexit? And I'm just like, UK government doesn't know. And so I don't know. Like, no one knows what's going on. And yeah, it's wow. Just, I'm the Brexit girl in the company. There's the whole tea thing, and these other kind of preconceptions, and the whole do you live near London, like where are you from, is that near London thing.
Right, it's just, you know, I think one of the things that I found as well is that and I've said this before, it might as well say, it used to, thank God it doesn't anymore, but it may as well have said, ask me about Trump on my forehead when I first, when he was first elected. Yeah. And it was so frustrating to have to answer for the things that were happening in my country when I wasn't there.
They're just like, what is your country doing? Why are they doing this?
And one of the things that just like... I found really interesting that you mentioned to me, was that Germans are so much more abreast on like current affairs, and they, you know, read the newspaper, read what's happening in the world, and want you to be able to talk about it. Do you find that in order to be taken seriously, you've got to sort of be as clued up as everyone else is on current events?
Yeah, I could have, I mean, at least that's my experience. You know, a lot of the Germans that I've come into contact with are certainly, hot on that sort of thing, certainly more than my old colleagues and stuff in the UK were. So yeah, I think there was a little bit of that there. No, I do not feel like I have to, but I feel like it's another plus to being able to network here, like being able to talk about, because Germans don't really do small talk. So
unlike the English,
it's like just go in with the big stuff, with the current affairs. The only small talk, Germans are excellent at talking about the weather. That is the only small talk they will do.
You must be brilliant at talking about the weather coming from the
UK. Which, yeah, as a Brit, yeah, that is, I can also do that exceptionally well.
I think that's my biggest response when people say, okay, so what, you know, what is it like networking in the UK? It's the small talk feature. It's the, you have to have that, I'm not going to call it banter because it's not really banter. It's almost like a patter of when you first meet someone of, yeah, you all right. That kind of thing has to get out of the way. And then tea or coffee and how many sugars, and that has to get out of the way. And then weather, and then how was your journey? And then you can start to talk about.
There's like a hierarchy of small talk in Britain. It's like start at the top and work your way down.
Pre-pandemic, when I first got to the UK, I was not ready for the double kiss. And I thought it was just something you did with friends and family. But even in business, you know, especially, you know, woman to woman, if I'm meeting a new woman, I quite frequently would, you know, go in and do a double air kiss. Do you find that the greeting is the same in Germany?
In my experience, it's definitely, in business, it's definitely more formal. It's pre-COVID. It was pretty much always a handshake. Yeah, I found that quite odd, especially if it was like when I went into my interview and stuff and I met my new boss, he just shook my hand. And that was quite odd because I'm so used to men.
Yeah.
You shake the hand, but then you go in for a cheek kiss, right?
Yes.
The feminist in me is like, yes, thank God.
What you said about men coming in for, because I always find that it's a man, especially like an older man, that comes in and actually touches their lips on my face.
Right. So normally it's like, it's like a kiss, but it's just the cheek sort of thing. Right. Yeah. Yeah. The older men are just like, get in there.
It is funny. I mean, I think greeting people is obviously the beginning of like a networking relationship. And obviously we've talked about like being intentional around networking, you know, when you get to a new country. I mean, do you find, and this is a, you know, I think probably the biggest portion of networking cross-culturally is the confidence factor, the mental health factor as well. I found that moving somewhere new is probably one of the scariest and also loneliness experiences I've ever had. And I really took advantage of all of the different little pockets of communities I had created in my hometown that I didn't recognize I had lost when I got here. What kind of tips do you have for someone, especially because there's so many people in London who are here speaking English as their second language? You know, right. What kind of confidence tips do you have for people who are putting themselves out there, speaking a second language, and obviously trying to make contacts that can open them up to these communities that they've lost?
It sounds so easy to say it, right? But, and I, for a long time, I struggled to get over this, but once you get over the fear of just speaking the language, I still don't know all German. I'm terrible at speaking it. And so I understand a lot more than I speak. And it's just kind of getting over that fear, that barrier, which I think you face when you're learning a second language or a third language or a fourth language, just speaking without fear of mistakes. Because, I mean, especially here, the Germans will correct you when you you make a mistake, but the majority of people want to help you. They want to help you get better. So I think it's just jumping over that initial hurdle of the fear and just diving into speaking the language and just having a go.
And I think the other thing that I wanted to kind of ask, as far as someone who is British, who might be, because I find that there's a lot of people who are in London or in the rest of the UK, but are from another place, and they struggle to understand the British and understand where they should, you know, where they should fit in with the culture here. And I just wonder, what are your tips for breaking what people perceive to be the ice in British culture? But what would you say is probably sort of a tip for someone looking to understand the British culture and try and network their way into the hearts of the British?
The thing that's just come to my mind is try and moan with them about something.
I love
which
it.
Is a bit of an odd one, but yeah, I mean, I don't know, this is a really old thing because nobody really goes to the post office anymore, in line for the post office and just, or in a queue for anything, because that's all we do in Britain is queue. and just be like, oh, you know, this queue was taking forever, and it breaks down. That gets people talking, definitely, because moaning is up there with the weather on our number one list of moaning, queuing, and talking about the weather.
Yeah, I've actually found that. I found that if you're talking about a delayed train, like if you ask somebody, oh, when do you think it's going to come, or you know, what's the latest update on this, they'll talk to you. You know, someone who is an expat and has an accent, I find that having the accent actually breaks the ice as well. So people will ask me where I'm from, and they want to tell me where they've been on holiday in America, or where they've, you know, they've got a cousin that's living in Boston or something.
Yeah.
Do you think that having a British accent has helped you abroad to kind of break the ice a little bit?
Yeah, definitely. Especially here, like I said, there's a lot of Germans really love the English and British culture. We've all met the Queen. We all drink tea and love it. That sort of thing. And so yeah, it has definitely helped.
I wanted to talk a little bit about your blogging, because I really love it. And I've seen just all the visuals as well of your blog and talking about recycling and all types of really cool stuff. So have you found that with blogging, you've been exposed to new people and new networks because you are obviously promoting your blog, you are, you know, I don't know, collaborating, those types of things? How has blogging really helped you to expand your network, or vice versa? How has networking helped you with your blogging?
Yeah, I think it's definitely worked both ways. Kind of linking my Instagram with the blog as well. But yeah, blogging has definitely opened up my network too, because there are people that I've been in contact with that read my blog but aren't on Instagram. They just read the blog every time that I upload, which is lovely. But it's new people for me to talk to. But yeah, definitely through Instagram. It's allowed me to meet new people, and it's expanded my creativity as well, because so many other people that I've met on Instagram also have blogs, which I love, and it's really kind of helped expand my creativity, which I feel like has been locked away for so long, and I'm finally kind of opening it back up again, which is great. Now that I've got a little bit more confident with it and in myself and what I want to do, I'm hoping to kind of take that on and start doing some collaboration posts myself. It's been almost like a lifesaver for me here, especially to combat the loneliness, and then also with obviously COVID in lockdown. It's given me a bit of a purpose, I think.
I think as well, when you are blogging, it's kind of like an extension of your story, and you're communicating to a wider audience, almost like having a multiple conversations at once in a way, and then you have people respond to that.
That always really surprises me, but in a good way, because I'm like, oh, people are actually finding this stuff, and obviously for like finding it helpful and seeing which posts have been read as well kind of gives me an idea of like, okay, this is obviously interesting to people, so maybe I should do more of this. Yeah, it's got a wider readership than I actually ever thought that it would have. I thought it would always just be like my family and friends. It's grown a lot over the past year, and it's pretty good.
There's so many people out there, especially within travel, who have blogs. What would be your tip for making a blog, you know, successful and growing it over a period of time?
Mine has been invest in it. And by invest, I mean, my blog has been my playground. Learning like SEO and all of that kind of stuff has been of interest to me. Yeah, I think definitely just investing the time to actually learn rather than just throwing words on a page with a picture and just sending it out to the world. Actually invest and research in your blog posts, research what you're doing.
Last question I have for you. I wanted to talk a little bit, because I know we're from the same sort of generation, and I wondered, because my Facebook group is called Networking for Millennials, and it was really deliberate because I felt like we really were the generation that was raised on Game Boys, Nintendo 64s, you know, TV, the beginning of the internet, and did we really learn what our parents learned as far as creating meaningful relationships? I'm not sure I've seen that in my generation. What is your take on our generation's ability to network? And what do you think is the biggest thing that we need to get better at? Because this is why I believe in networking so much. It's a way to overcome all of those barriers and, you know, overcoming. I was just on a podcast the other day about not being born with a silver spoon in your mouth. So what do you think networking can do for millennials, and how can we learn how to do it better?
With our generation, it's more collaborative. So the stuff that we do is definitely more collaborative, I think, than maybe our parents' generation. I think it's taking that kind of collaborative approach, community, I think, rather than, because so many as well, you know, my parents grew up knowing someone who knew someone, the next door neighbor knew someone that could get them a job, right?
Yeah.
When we moved into our first house that we rented, we didn't know any of our neighbors, because it's just like transpired now that you just don't really speak to your neighbors or to anyone that isn't already in your immediate circle, sort of thing. So I definitely think that we could probably get better. I think we are getting better. I think we're learning at building communities, be that online or in person when we can be in a person, large group of people again. But yeah, I think that's probably thing that I need to get better at, and confidence. I think I struggled with confidence because we were raised with TV and the internet and that sort of thing. I think we kind of lost confidence, but.
Yeah, I feel like the ability to entertain yourself and just be weird and creative and entertain yourself by, I don't know, pretending that the floor is lava. I feel like that kind of thing that I used to do before I was introduced to my phone, the internet, all that kind of stuff. I look at my little brother and the generation coming up behind us, and I don't know how they're even going to understand how to communicate without sliding into the DMs. I genuinely am worried about it. But also, one of the things I've always, and I'm not sure if this is more of an American thing, but one of the things I've always found is that there's a big competition factor that is instilled in, maybe it's more of a Western thing, but it's a real competition factor instilled in us from a young age of there can only be one winner. And, you know, there can only be one person that's top of the class. And I think that was the biggest thing I really wanted to get away from, was this idea that there isn't enough success going around and that we all have to compete in order to get there. So this community factor that you talked about is super important, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely. I think you're right. And I think even more so, particularly for women, I would probably say, because I think, I don't know, men maybe see the competition factor a little bit differently, but there was always this kind of like thing that women have to be like catty and bitchy with each other and stuff, right? And it's just like, I actually know we're all like capable of doing different things, and we all have unique ways of doing stuff and seeing the world. So what happens if we do it together and then we all get a piece of the pie, right? And we all get a bit of success. It's like that bit in Mean Girls where she breaks the crown.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just I'd much rather see, for me, my heart fills so much when I see my friends succeeding, like doing good things. That brings me so much joy. And that's what I think really needs to happen with world of work and the world of networking and stuff, is we all just need to be like helping each other, lifting each other up.
Yes. I love that. And I think that's like what makes me feel warm and fuzzy inside, is this idea that we're all like helping each other to all, because everyone has an individual place where they want to go. Everyone has an individual. I always feel like I want to ask, like, I feel like it's such a personal question, but I always ask people, you know, like, what is it you want to do? Like, what is it you ultimately want to achieve? Because that's what I want to help people get to. And obviously there's so many other people that can then help me to help them. And do you know what I mean? It's just this big kind of kumbaya type situation that, quite frankly, I didn't grow up thinking. I thought it was a competition. Like, I didn't study with my colleagues in college because I was like, if I tell you, then I'm not going to get a good grade. You know, that kind of thing was, I really had to unlearn it. And it's kind of like you said, with women, there's so few places for women in successful roles that it's almost like we feel like we have to compete for that one spot. And it's just not necessary. So I think we are definitely a good example of collaboration and women helping women. And, but yeah, I want you to tell everybody how they can get in touch with you and where they can find you on Instagram and read your blog.
Yeah. So I am on Instagram. It's at The Adventures of Steffi, which is Steffi with two F's. And the blog is adventuresofsteffi.com. I do have a Facebook page, but I'm terrible at Facebook. So yeah, it's just Instagram and the blog, really. Yeah.
Love it. Honestly, it's been an absolute pleasure having you. And I've just enjoyed getting your perspective on life in Germany. It's definitely making me even more desperate to get out there. So cheers to that. And yeah. I hope we have many, many more to come.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you so much for having me on.
No worries.